Welcome back, everybody. NHL Fantasy on Ice. Pete Jensen, Rob Reese here with you talking fantasy hockey and previewing the 2020-21 season, whenever it begins. Sounds like it could be mid-January, Robbie. We're staying optimistic here, but great to be here with you, buddy.
Likewise, Pete. Good to see you. Bobby, good to see you as well. And we've done some episodes so far in the off season. We've done some deep sleepers. We've done some bounce back players, all sorts of situations like that. But for today's episode, it should be a good one. We're going to do player debates and some contract year stuff. This is going to be an imperative episode if you guys are drafting in the next couple weeks here and you're kind of stuck between one or two players, Pete.
And hey, it'll also offer some explanation. When we post the rankings list, people say, how in the world do you have Nathan MacKinnon over Connor McDavid? How do you have, you know, Leon Draisaitl over Auston Matthews? We're here to explain that for you here. We've already gone in depth on the McDavid McKinnon comparison, but just like we always talk about plus minus and how the team security, team strength helps McKinnon compared to McDavid. Another thing to bring to light, right, Robbie? Highest shot volume in the NHL last year was Nathan MacKinnon, over 300 shots, usually over a full season. So, you know, that's just another thing, another egg in McKinnon's basket that could make him arguably the best fantasy player if and when he leads the league in scoring. I think that year is coming up soon.
This is for all the folks on Twitter who come at us and say, how did you do that? How did you do this? How is this guy ahead of this guy? How does this make sense? Listen to this episode, Petey and Robbie, and I'll chime in when necessary. We'll let you know. And we are the final judge and jury. So what we say goes. But listen to this episode because it's going to have some fascinating debates and it's going to settle and answer all your questions that you throw out there regularly to Pete and Rob on Twitter. Why is this happening? Why is that happening? How could this be? Well, listen up. And I'm going to lay out for Robbie.
All right, so back to MacKinnon versus McDavid, the good stuff here. Obviously, we have MacKinnon ranked first overall, Pete, and I know a lot of people are saying McDavid is the tried and true number one, and I'm not going to put up too much of a fuss against that. I think that's fair. Draisaitl is fair almost in that conversation with MacKinnon and McDavid too. Let's be honest. If you have a top three pick in fantasy, you're choosing one of those three players. At the end of the day, when all the fantasy points are tallied up at the end of the season, we might be looking at a difference of 5 to 10 fantasy points at most. So this is not going to make or break you. This is almost a personal preference. The reason why I chose Nathan MacKinnon first overall, Pete, is because of what you mentioned, shots on goal. That is just the extra anchor in your week-to-week matchup that can weigh you heavier than your opponent. I think when you've got a high volume shooter, you've got a goal scorer, and you've got a guy who I think is poised for 100 plus points this season, if it were over in 82 games, obviously if it's condensed, you know, the point per game is plus is still going to check out. But I think when you have a guy, it's a volume shooter on a team that's as secure as Colorado, I would just choose to be a little bit more cautious with the first overall pick than take a guy on the Edmonton Oilers.
And when MacKinnon came into the league, he was lights out, unbelievable. But the team around him had some holes. And I think we saw that floor that next season when they really regressed. But now with the team security, there's no way that the floor is anywhere near as low as it was that year. You're talking about even if his shooting percentage goes down, he's still going to rack up like, what, 50 assists and, you know, some big numbers like that on the power play, 25, 30 power play points at the absolute bare minimum. So yeah, MacKinnon's just such a great option. I think in terms of ceiling for points only leagues, we always have to make that clear. Like obviously the top two players in those rankings would be McDavid and Draisaitl. Nobody could dispute that, but we've been kind of beating the drum here that MacKinnon, his point ceiling could be in the same vicinity as McDavid's, which is significant because I think the past two seasons, when I was looking back at Yahoo rankings, MacKinnon has actually finished ahead of McDavid 2 years running. Not many people realize that in the standard categories.
Well, he had 365 shots in 2018-19. Ridiculous. Crazy. He had 318 shots last year and 93 points in 69 games, including 31 power play points at least in each of his past three seasons in a row. And this team just continues to improve. We saw Andrei Burakovsky take a step. Cale Makar looks like he's going to be one of the top defensemen in the league for the next decade plus. Mikko Rantanen is a phenomenal right wing on the top line. So I think what you just have all the boxes ticked for MacKinnon that you want in fantasy when it comes to exposure, when it comes to coaching, usage, all of those things go in McKinnon's favor. I think McDavid is also a solid pick here. You can't go wrong either way. There's no question. But I think in terms of bang for your buck in a week-to-week match, if you're playing full cats, I think you're going Nate McKinnon.
And the underrated option of all of this is, you know, look at Draisaitl, who had 110 points in a shortened season and led the NHL not only in scoring but also power play points on a separate line from McDavid, which is like crazy because you look at McDavid being, you know, the tried and true number one player. You can't go wrong taking him if that's your belief. And, you know, even though we have McKinnon over him, we still believe that he's worthwhile as a number one pick as well. But it's crazy that he might not even be the best fantasy player on his own team, for God's sake. I mean, that's crazy.
In this situation, honestly, fellas, I'd rather not have the first pick. I'd rather not have to make this decision. Whoever falls to me, if they want to take McDavid first, great, I get McKinnon. They want to take McKinnon first, great, I get McDavid. I don't have to be sitting there all season long wondering if I made the right decision. Honestly, it's razor thin between these two players. We keep saying it, you can't go wrong. Really, we can't go wrong. So let's move off of these two players. And Draisaitl is right up there in the top five player pick also, right?
So I would look at Draisaitl versus Matthews as more of a comparable debate. I think Draisaitl, you know, you could take him one overall. I'm not going to put up a fuss with that. But I think if you're looking at absolute maximum value, you're looking at Mac/McDavid at one. And then when you draft 2, 3, 4, 5, that's where Bob, a player is going to fall to you that you're not going to have to think too much about. But if it is Draisaitl, if he's on the board, if Matthews is on the board, you really are going to have to weigh what's most important to you. And I think that's always the way that I draft in fantasy. If I want goals, I'm taking Auston Matthews because his goal scoring ceiling is untapped. If I want points, I'm taking Draisaitl just because the Edmonton Oilers, whether they're going to allow a lot of goals, they're going to score a lot of goals. But I think when it comes to that third or fourth pick, I'm going with Auston Matthews. There's something, Pete, I like about a player that we haven't seen their full potential yet. I like that he stayed healthy last year. He logged a lot of minutes for the Toronto Maple Leafs. And I think he has another gear that I think Draisaitl has already hit, but Matthews could be even a little bit higher if he reaches it.
Sure. We mentioned it before that we think over a full season, he has 60 goal potential. And last year you look at even strength goal leaders in the NHL, Ovechkin was tied with Auston Matthews with 35. So, and Matthews had like close to 50 last year, even though it was a shortened year. So yeah, Matthews total security blanket out there with Marner, some points outside out there with, Tavares on the power play out there with William Nylander, who he has great chemistry with from previous seasons. So another very, very high floor player who's going to get you a plus rating and a pretty good one at that, similar to what McKinnon's going to get you. And I know that the back end of Toronto is not nearly as strong as, say, Colorado's, but hey, it got a little better, right? They got TJ Brody. They got the kid Lettinen from Finland. They got Barry out of the picture, which I think is addition by subtraction in terms of defensive help. And Frederik Andersen is in a contract year. So you know that he's going to put his best foot forward, I think.
And I think what you mentioned with even strength goals, we know Auston Matthews can score at even strength, but I think he has room to grow on the power play. He's had 12 power play goals in each of the past two seasons. But I think if their power play stays healthy, we saw Mitch Marner miss time last year. We saw John Tavares had a broken finger last year. They couldn't decide between Barry or Riley on the top unit last year. With a fully healthy power play heading into the mid-January season here for the Toronto Maple Leafs, you're going to see them click from day one. That's not going to be an issue for them this season. And Matthews can get above 15 power play goals this season. Even if it's shortened, he can have a career high in that category. Now, Draisaitl, you have to give him credit, 16 power play goals for him in each of the past two seasons. That's no slouch, but I just think that Matthews, we have that untapped little hashtag, that little asterisk next to his name on the power play still too.
Room to grow. He's got room to grow. And that's why I'll take Matthews over Draisaitl. Draisaitl probably has some room to grow also, but wow. I just sense an emerging, an avalanche sort of feel with Matthews that he's just going to keep coming and coming and coming and getting better and better and better. Draisaitl, you could argue that case also, but as Rob said, Toronto has some room to grow here. I think they're going to improve. I think they're going to be better than they were last year, which is not saying much. They're going to be better than they were last year. I'll take Matthews over Draisaitl if I had to make that choice.
I'm going Draisaitl right now, but I would be happy to have like the fourth or fifth pick in any fantasy draft, because even if all these guys are off the board, you're probably getting either Matthews or Kucherov or, you know, Panarin, someone like that. I mean, there's some ridiculous options. All those guys probably hitting 100 points over a full season. And yeah, I think Kucherov, there's a case for him to be taken as high as anyone as well. I saw in Yahoo's rankings, we'll have Scott Pianowski on later in the season, in the preseason to explain himself. But Kucherov was number one. That was pretty surprising, but not really when you look back at his track record. And I think he's first or second in the league in scoring over the past two seasons combined.
If we're talking goals, we're talking Alex Ovechkin, pound for pound, dollar for dollar, the best fantasy player of the past decade. There's nobody close in Yahoo's rankings, especially when they switched over to hits coverage. It's not even close anymore. So you're looking at a 5th, 6th, 7th overall pick, Pete. I think you like the left wing position for Ovechkin, but what about Mika Zibanejad now in that range? The Rangers are kind of a hot team. They're trendy. Zibanejad broke out with 41 goals last year. I seen a lot of chatter about him on Twitter, people saying, you know, if I've got that 5th, 6th, 7th pick, I'm looking at Zibanejad. Are you looking at Zibanejad there, or are you going with the industry standard in Ovi?
Hang tight on that question real, Pete. I have to ask you this. I have to get some clarification. Scott Pianowski has Kucherov ranked number one. Is that correct? Is that what
Yahoo
you said?
Yahoo does, and Pianowski is usually the guy drives the ship on that one. So, well, again, we'll have him on later in the preseason when we know when it's going to start. We'll see if he has, you know, maybe some stage fright and he goes back to, you know, one of the tried and true guys. But yeah, I did see Kucherov at the top of Yahoo's rankings for what it's worth. I think Zibanejad was really an interesting player last season, led the entire NHL in goals per game, missed some time, still scored 40 plus, could have been right up there with Pasternak and Ovi if he played the full season. And if everybody remembers that 5-goal game for Zibanejad, it was kind of that back and forth, Ovi, Big Z, back to Ovi, Zibanejad wins it in overtime. That was a crazy game and maybe a sign of things to come, that this could actually be a fair debate. That said, I'm going with Ovi. Technically, it's his contract year. We know he's not going to any other NHL team. He's hinted at that many times, but you know, just an opportunity here with a new coach, Laviolette, contract year, maybe get paid for another couple more years. I'm banking on Ovi for another like 200 plus hit season, 300 plus shots. These are over 82 games, so prorate them based on whatever it is. But Ovi's so much safer. Zibanejad's shooting percentage was really high last year and could certainly come down a bit.
That's what I was going to mention, 19.7% for Zibanejad. I like the player. He's dominant. He's on a great team. But you cannot put all of your chips, especially if you've got that 5th or 6th pick in fantasy, you can't put it on a player that could easily regress based on shooting percentage alone. Ovi does not have that issue, Pete. And the thing about Alex Ovechkin that no one's really talking about, on the power play last season, he only had 13 power play goals. That was his fewest since 2011-2012. Power play points last year, he only had 18. 18 power play points was the fewest of his entire NHL career. With Peter Laviolette coming in there, giving the guy some juice, that power play is not going to be as anemic as it was last year. And with John Carlson now emerging as probably the top power play defenseman in fantasy, Pete, I think you're going to see a big year from number 8. He's well rested. When's the last time Ovi got this much rest? Never, never. He's never been off for this long. He's in great shape. I think he's going to come out and just score a ton of goals. And especially, guys, if this season is condensed and they're playing a lot of games in succession, that's where Ovi thrives. Other players get left behind in that environment. Ovi can play, you know, however many minutes a game. He's a tank, and he can score night after night after night. When he stays hot, he's going to light the lamp a lot this year.
And because of all the category coverage, the power play, the hits, the goals, every single year when he has a down year, still scores over 30 goals and still finishes in the top 10 overall players in standard league. So he has Ovechkin, the highest floor maybe of any fantasy player in any sport. I think you can make that argument because he always finishes in the top 10. So therefore, he has to be the safest pick if he falls to you at 5, 6, 7, even 8. You know,
So let's duck out of the first round here, maybe early second, Pete. Let's stay with forwards, though, for the minute. We've got Sebastian Aho and Brayden Point. Probably guys you're going to see go around maybe 10, as high as 10, and maybe as low as 15 or 16 in drafts, depending on your league preferences and scoring. So when you look at these two players, I think it has to be said, we have to start with Brayden Point here, just because of his dominance in the postseason as a top line player for the Lightning, as a high minutes player for the Lightning. I think you give the edge just on that to Point right now. But Pete, I mean, you and I both saw it. Carolina solidified themselves last year as not only a good team, but a great team, not only in the league, but in fantasy as well.
Oh, Carolina, Carolina, nothing finer than Carolina. Oh, Svechnikov. Oh, Brenda Moore, nothing finer than Carolina. No, sorry guys. I went off on the tangent there, but honestly, just so the folks know this at home, we're getting these questions from people on Twitter, these matchups between players and whatnot. So we're not grabbing these out of thin air. People have interacted with us on the social media and have asked us about these players in these, you know, head-to-head debates. So we're throwing them out there, and that's where they're coming from. So now, Carolina, Pete, go ahead. Sorry, I riffed there a little bit.
Yeah, so I really like Brayden Point in this comparison against Aho, but talk about two guys that really went full throttle in the playoffs this past year. What, 8 points in the three games against the Rangers and the three-game sweep in the first round for Sebastian Aho? And you look at maybe one of the best, if not the best, line trios in the NHL, up and coming already among the top 5 or 10 with Aho, Svechnikov, and Teravainen. I mean, all three of those guys deserve to be taken in the top 50, and Svechnikov and Aho now deserve to be taken in the top 20 because they were, what, top 30 overall players last year, and then they, you know, went bombs away in the playoffs. So, yeah, there's a good argument for Carolina, and that includes Dougie Hamilton, who's in a contract year. I know we have a debate including him later that we'll get to, but, yeah, I think that definitely Brayden Point, the emergence of him in recent seasons, like 2 years ago, the guy scored 90-plus points, and then this past year he was, like, top 50, which was still pretty darn good, but in the playoffs, I mean, nobody was better than that guy. He led the NHL in goals in the postseason. So to me, like, that breaks the tie. Like, if you took Kucherov in the first round and then somehow Points available in the second, like, don't even think twice about it. Go to bat with those Lightning guys every day of the week.
100%. I mean, that would be the ideal situation in fantasy. That would be my draft strategy if you could pull that one off. Even if you go with a Kucherov or a Hedman in round two, like, any kind of high-end stack like that with two guys is a money in the bank strategy. I'll make a case for Aho here. I agree with you, Pete. I'm definitely, if it were me drafting, I would take Point over Aho. But let me just present this to you guys. Sebastian Aho is a player that we've got 30 goals in 2018-19. We got 38 goals in this last season in 68 games. And the thing with Aho that I think you could really drive home here is that Andrei Svechnikov has a ton of room to grow. This is a player in Svechnikov that could break out this year and score at a 50-goal pace, and it wouldn't shock anybody on this program. So I think when you look at that, that's the one area where I say, okay, well, Brayden Point already has Kucherov now. We know what Kucherov does. He's one of the best players in the league. But I think when you look at Aho, you have to say this might be the year where you jump, you maybe reach for him a little bit just because you're going to bank on Svechnikov being an elite player in the league. Now, if this happens this season and Svechnikov turns out to be elite, this is the only year where you're going to be able to take Aho in that 10 to 15 range. If Svechnikov breaks out full-fledged this year, Aho is going to be a top 10 player in fantasy moving forward.
And we look back to that draft class, right, where you have Dahlin, Svechnikov, Brady Tkachuk. I mean, all guys with further room to grow. And I think Svechnikov, the fact that he's in the top three left wings in fantasy, I know partially because Brad Marchand is injured and is likely going to miss the first couple of weeks, maybe even a month of the season, depending on when it starts. So that's, you know, take that with a grain of salt. That's why Marchand isn't in the top three. But you're looking at Panarin, Ovechkin, and then the next man up is Svechnikov. And that's coming off a breakout season, which was not full-fledged. He could get up into the 80s in points. He could get up to the 40s in goals. And a very, very strong team around him, you know, especially if you look at, like, I just mentioned Dahlin, like, he's in line for a full-fledged breakout eventually, but doesn't have the team strength around him. Whereas, you know, one of the best forward defenseman connections in the entire NHL that nobody knows about is Hamilton to Svechnikov, bing, bang, boom, power play goal. And yeah, that they're going to rack those up this year.
Now, I've had a lot of people on Twitter. I do the defenseman rankings and I list them out nearly every week here, but a lot of people tell me that I have Dougie Hamilton ranked too high. You can look at this list, nhl.com/fantasy, and follow it along there. But let's all keep in mind one thing with Dougie Hamilton. Not only was he the best defenseman in fantasy prior to him getting injured last season, so there's that, but he's going to be entering a contract year, Pete, in which he could become an unrestricted free agent at the end of this season. You're telling me Dougie Hamilton could potentially score a point per game as a defenseman this season and then cash out on a max deal in Carolina? You don't think that he has edge this year? Like, if you're looking at Roman Josi and Norris Winner versus Dougie Hamilton, would you not take Dougie Hamilton because he's in a contract year?
The one argument for Josi is that he's by far the best player on his team, and that's something we always preach. Like, if you know a guy is going to be the single best player on his team, play 24 minutes as a defenseman and lead them in scoring like he did last year by almost 20 points, it's very appealing. But Dougie Hamilton, higher ceiling. I believe the past three seasons combined, he leads all defensemen in goals. And last year, of course, like you mentioned, he was the best before his injury. And then he didn't come back until the playoffs, which happened in, what, July? So, I mean, it was a crazy long absence for him. It was really unfortunate. But, yeah, the contract year, can definitely see some dollars in his eyes, especially when you see the deals, the long-term deals handed out to players like Torrey Krug, Pietrangelo, and you look at Hamilton being in his prime, a guy that has bounced around from a couple of different teams, right? I mean, he's settled in Carolina, probably wants to stay there long-term. And even if he doesn't, he's going to get paid big time if he has even half the season that he had last year over a full season.
I'm laughing off camera here because I remember last season, Pete, Davey Satriano, we're in a weird league where I think you can only start one or two defensemen. It was an ESPN league, and he dropped Dougie Hamilton, I think, like the first week because he wanted to prioritize having Roman Josi. And Bob, I came in there, I swooped up Dougie Hamilton off of waivers. My team got off to a bad start, so I had the first claim. And I rode Dougie Hamilton to like second or third place alone until he got injured. But that's just like the epitome of a player like Dougie Hamilton that can absolutely take your fantasy team from the cellar to the top of the leaderboard just on his category coverage alone. And I think, Bobby, in a contract year, you just can't turn away from that. This is that individual motivation for a player to make a good living for his future could make all the difference in fantasy. You say, oh, that's reading too deep. I disagree. I think that sets the difference here. And Nashville, tell me there's a quicker team in NHL history to go from contender to pretender faster than the Predators.
It was worth you interrupting me to hear that Davey Satriano failure story, for sure. All I was going to say, I'm a Dougie Hamilton guy. I would lean to Dougie Hamilton. I don't need to reiterate what you guys just said. Contract year, the works. I also know what I'm getting out of Carolina a little more than I know what I'm getting out of Nashville. Carolina, a team emerging, a team that's consistent, coach, Svechnikov, Aho, you know, young players, hate the goaltending, but doesn't play into the Dougie Hamilton scoring goals, contract year, dollar signs in his eyes. Give me Dougie. I'll take Dougie.
And the other thing about Josi that maybe some of the luster could wear off is that even though he's the best player on Nashville, they may not be very good. And last year was when, remember when Subban was still out there on the power play so much and they traded him to New Jersey. And then Josi was the number one guy again, which he hadn't been in a long time because it was Shea Weber there. Then it was Suter there. And then it was, you know, of course, Subban there to split time with him. And, you know, I just think like last year was that breakthrough bounce back for Josi to have the best season of his career. And maybe this year he'll still lead Nashville in scoring, but maybe it'll be more like 50 points as opposed to 61 or whatever he had last year. So that's another thing, maybe why you lean towards the ceiling based on a safer player compared to a safer player.
And I think it has to be said that Nashville is not as bad as they were in fantasy last year, but I don't think they're as good as they were in fantasy years prior to that. I think they're somewhere in between, which is really kind of an average team overall and an average team in fantasy. So that's just something to weigh when you have a high draft pick like that and you're thinking about two elite guys. Again, you probably can't go wrong either way, but more often than not, I'm siding with a guy in a contract year. Now, Pete, two defensemen that I wanted to talk about today, I know you mentioned him earlier, is Dahlin versus a guy like Heiskanen, who had arguably the best postseason out of anybody, just in terms of proving himself this year. So when you look at these two players, Dahlin obviously has the tool set to be a Nick Lindstrom type player in the league, which will return many dividends in fantasy if you play full categories. But what we saw out of Heiskanen, it's just such a recent memory. I think in fantasy, you might see a lot of fantasy managers drafting a player like Heiskanen over Dahlin just on recency bias.
For sure. I mean, he had one of probably the 10 or 15 best scoring defenseman seasons in NHL history as the Stars went to the Cup final and lost to Tampa Bay. So, and he was, for much of the postseason, was at or very close to a point per game. So very tough to do as a defenseman, especially when you're not playing on power play one. That's my only concern with Heiskanen. I mean, could he hit 60 points without being on power play one? It's going to be tough to do. I think if anybody could do it, it's a player like him. I do trust what he's done to this point in his career over Dahlin, who's kind of like, you know, you expect it to eventually happen, but you just don't have 100% faith in Eichel and Taylor Hall and some of these other guys. And, you know, just the thought of the Sabres maybe being lumped into that metropolitan division just kind of scares me off in that debate. I think that Heiskanen's a little bit safer here. But yeah, I mean, if you're looking at ceiling, it's like Dahlin's going to be out there with Hall and Eichel. And if those guys score 80, 90 points a piece, then, you know, Dahlin's going to get 60 in his sleep, I think.
Does it surprise you that Dahlin had as many power play points as Cale Makar and Tony DeAngelo last season?
Yeah, it surprises me that he had the same as Cale Makar. That shows you he's getting more out of what's around him than Makar maybe is. I mean, Makar, the talent is not even close from Colorado to Buffalo, even if you incorporated Taylor Hall. So, yeah, I think that with Cale Makar, there's that other debate that we talked about in a previous episode, right? Between Cale Makar and Quinn Hughes, we're going to revisit it probably every year until the end of time when those guys retire someday, probably 15, 20 years from now, because they're both absolute beasts. And I think Quinn Hughes has a little bit higher ceiling in year two, but that's arguable. I mean, Makar is a really safe pick who has taken advantage of everything in front of him so far in the NHL.
I think that stat with 19 power play points being ninth, tie for ninth in the league among defensemen, is going to make me go with Dahlin here. Just look, and I'm not betting on Buffalo. I'm not going anywhere near their point total this season. I'm not going to make a case here for Linus Ullmark to be a top five goalie in the league. You're not hearing that from me. But I think if we're looking at fantasy value alone, forget Buffalo making the playoffs, I'm not breaking any of that down right now. I'm just looking at fantasy value in the regular season. And I think with the influx of points from Taylor Hall on that team, with that high energy, high tempo, finally, that Eichel can play with consistently on the top line now, I think that's going to be a big ripple down effect at even strength for Dahlin. But then when it comes to the power play with Taylor Hall out there, with Olsen on the right side, with Eichel, I mean, these are absolute goal scorers. So I just want to see Dahlin set and teeing up three options for one-timers on the power play. I think you're looking at 25 power play points there. Again, that would project out to an 82-game regular season, but still, that's high caliber for a defenseman. And I think that Dahlin, too, his goal total was very low last year. His shooting percentage was low. I still think he can bury the puck a bit more than what we saw. And when you've got a guy like Olofsson on the right side, you've got a guy like Hall on the left side, the goalie is going to have to be moving a lot more side to side, which opens up a lane for Dahlin to shoot a lot more this season.
I think it would take some courage to take Dahlin over Makar. I know Dahlin is a nice player. I know he's going to get better.
No. We're not talking about no way. That's not even a debate. Okay. No chance.
Okay, so what are you arguing?
Dahlin over Heiskanen, maybe. Just because they're both around the same age. They're both kind of blossoming.
Okay.
And
okay,
we haven't seen as much from Dahlin quite yet. But
okay, I don't have much of a gap. I don't have much of a take on the Dahlin Heiskanen. I thought you guys were going back and forth on Dahlin Makar, and it's clear as day you got to take Makar over Dahlin.
No, okay. The only argument with the only player you could compare Makar to is Hughes, and that's a good debate. But when it comes to Dahlin versus Heiskanen, I think it's close. The only reason I might go Dahlin is just because I think that Buffalo really is one of the true most improved teams of the offseason, and I'm just intrigued. I just want to see them put it together. Maybe that is more of a gut feeling for me, but I think Buffalo deserves it. They've got a great market up there. The fans deserve it to finally see that team be competitive to the point where they're even in the contention. And we've seen them start great the past two seasons. If they can just have a little bit more consistency, and maybe Taylor Hall provides that for them to eke out a couple of those close games, Pete, in the middle of the season, which they seem to have a little bit of a lull in, I think they'll be competitive. And I think Dahlin's really going to be the guy that we see kind of be the leader of that back end. So I think you're going to see a lot of big things for Dahlin this season. And Heiskanen is still a phenomenal talent, but Dallas is just a little bit banged up. They've got a little hangover from playing a lot of hockey. And Heiskanen, I mean, he's going to have to play 23, 24 minutes back there, where Dahlin, you could almost say you can get 20, 21 minutes out of the guy. I just like that situation for Dahlin slightly more in fantasy.
Yeah, the thing with Dallas, I said it a few episodes ago, hangover, tricky spot. They go all the way to the final. They lose, short turnaround, injuries galore. That's where I'm a little skeptical if I'm looking at Dallas. Like I said, I would take the under on the point total with Dallas because of their goalie situation, the injuries and whatnot. So yeah, okay, Dahlin over Heiskanen, don't have much of an issue with it.
And I think that Dahlin certainly has a chance, and the Sabres certainly have a chance to surprise people, even though they're the most improved team. A lot of people are still putting them down, saying, oh, you know, Hall's not going to work out and he's going to get traded before the deadline, all this doom and gloom. But remember the 2012-13 season when it was 48 games, you know, could be more than that, could be 50, 60. We don't know quite yet. But when you limit the number of games and you look at a team like Buffalo that, you, like you said, Robbie, has started hot each of the past 2 years and have struggled to sustain it, but now have better pieces in place to make some moves and maybe sustain what they're doing. That's where you look at a Buffalo team that could surprise maybe a team from the Metro that made the playoffs last year that we expect to make it again, but then Buffalo ends up jumping them to everybody's surprise because it's a short and condensed season where maybe some wacky things could happen.
Let's talk some goalies here. Number two overall goalies in our ranks. Again, NHL.com/fantasy. You can follow along there. We've got Hellebuck right now as the number two goalie, but I think you could make an argument for Tuukka Rask. I think you could make an argument for Carter Hart. Pete, I think you could maybe even throw in there Robin Lehner off the Vegas Golden Knights, one of the best teams in the league. So your preliminary feeling, number two goalie overall, Vassy's off the board. Who are you taking?
I've been looking at this one for a while. I feel like instead of taking Hellebuck in the late second or third round, I would rather take maybe Carter Hart in the late third or early fourth round. I'm not saying that Carter Hart at this point is better than Connor Hellebuck, but he just might be. He just might be that prodigy that we could talk all about all the other good goalies in the Metro, Shesterkin, Varlamov, Sorokin, all these guys. You know, Samsonov, but Carter Hart could still be head and shoulders above all those guys when we look, you know, this season, next season, a couple years down the road. So I'm more inclined to say my second favorite number one goalie to draft is Carter Hart behind Vasilevsky. That's just like my gut right now.
Wow.
Well, I think the potential is there, Bobby. I mean, for Hart to be that guy, right? Like one of the best goalies in the league. He was that at home last year. He was the best home goalie in the league. Him and Bass, right. Carter Hart was right there. Better save percentage, better even strength save percentage last year at home. Disaster on the road. So we'll have to see how this format shakes out. And maybe that'll give us an inclination if Hart can be that guy. But I'm going to go back to something I think Bob said on one of our postseason episodes. He was talking about the Boston Bruins. A lot of people were hopping off the Boston bandwagon when training camp started last season, before the postseason. People were saying, oh, they're banged up, they're not going to be as good. Boston was still really competitive despite all the guys playing through injuries, despite having some uncertainty, Rask going home early, all of that. They were still a great team. I think Boston this season is still that second best team in the league, even if Pasta's slow to start. with an injury, even if Marchand misses some games with an injury. I still think Boston has a lot of good depth. I think, Bob, I mean, you've always been a Rask guy. I think he's just so steady, no matter what his age is, no matter the situation, how many games he gets. Even if he starts less games, Pete, this year, I think I like Rask here at the number two spot, just because you know Halak's a proven backup, right? So there's no, absolutely no concern about that. I just think you're going to get quality starts, maybe fewer, but better quality starts from Rask over Hellebuck and over Hart.
Yeah, I think people are forgetting about Rask because of how it all shook out in the bubble and him going home, and it should really change the way he is going to be between the pipes. I like Rask also. I think you're jumping the shark a little bit with Carter Hart. You can make an argument for Carter Hart, but I need to see more games from Carter Hart before I start jumping him ahead of Tuukka Rask, who's on a really good Boston team. Even with the injuries, they're still going to be a pretty solid team, in my opinion. I would put Tuukka Rask there, but it's not clear. I need Davey Satriano to clear some things up here with the goaltenders. We got to get him on at some point because it is not clear. And you could make a case, as Pete just did with Carter Hart, and you could sit there and say, okay, I get it. I'll take Carter Hart. Me personally, I need to see a little bit more. And I'm surprised you didn't say Sorokin, Pete. I thought for sure you're going to say Sorokin there.
I mentioned Varlamov's name before Sorokin, so Bob didn't fight me on that one. But yeah, I do think that Hart is the best option there. I mean, you could say that Shesterkin has just as high of a ceiling, maybe has some more offensive support in the years to come, but I think Hart has done more with that young Flyers defense. Now, again, Niskanen retired, so it's like Provorov and all the young kids on defense for Philly. They also added, Gustavsson from the Flames/Blackhawks. So, you know, they have some good young options on defense, and I just think, like, even though the Flyers struggled to score in the postseason, they're much better than that over a full regular season. So he's going to get the goal support. The Flyers are hungry to prove their doubters wrong. And yeah, Carter Hart is, I think we have him ranked fourth or fifth, just because it gets kind of tricky with the timeshare guys, right? Like you mentioned Rask and Halak, both in contract years. Robin Lehner just got paid. He also has Fleury behind him. So if you want to get that first leg of a timeshare for the condensed season, I could see why you lean towards a timeshare versus a tried and true number one goalie, Vasilevsky or something like that, if you have to really take him in the first round, first five picks or so. So the timeshare strategy is real. I think we all recognize that.
I've cooled off a little bit on Lehner throughout the offseason. The more that I've researched Vegas, the more that I looked at Lehner's stats from last year, Pete, I've just cooled off a little bit on the player. I think when we were in peak Robin Lehner mode, I probably would have taken this guy as the second goalie. Now I've probably got him four or five. I'm not saying that he's going to underperform. He's a dynamite player. Great. One of the best success stories in the league when you consider off ice things and all of that. But I just think that, and you mentioned it with Hart, this is probably the last time where you're going to be able to get Hart early third round, late second round. I mean, after this season, he should prove himself to be, you know, a late first, early second round pick in fantasy. So I think you make a good point there, Pete. If it's going to happen, reach a little bit this year for him and you shouldn't be satisfied. But I'd like to talk about some of the contract year goalies here, Pete. We've got Grubauer. We've got Andersen. We've got Binnington, I believe. And these are all guys on pretty solid teams, Pete, with the Avs, with the Leafs, with the Blues. So, you know, when you're in round three, late round three, early round four, we see it every single draft. One person will take one of those guys, Binnington, boom, next pick, Grubauer, boom, next pick, Andersen. So if you've got that, which one would you take out of those three?
That's tough. I mean, I think I would take Freddie Andersen. It's a little bit against the grain just because I think people view the Blues as a stronger team after replacing Petrangelo with Krug. And even though Tarasenko is banged up, I mean, they're still such a strong power play even without him. And then, yeah, Grubauer is part of that timeshare that was one of the best in the league. You can knock them all you want for not having a certain number one goalie, but that timeshare is top five in the league. Nobody can dispute that with Grubauer and Francouz. But like at that stage of your draft, if you're looking at, you know, maybe a lesser number one overall goalie to start your roster with, look at the goal support in Toronto. Look at their top two lines at even strength. They're excellent. The power play is excellent. Freddie Andersen very quietly over his four seasons with the Leafs has a .916 save percentage. So you can't trash a guy for that. And the defense has been bad at different points in front of him over that stretch. So I'll give my vote to Frederik Andersen. A lot of people won't agree with me, but I think we've seen enough of him. And in a contract year, like you said, it's just the opportunity is here. If he has a bad year, he's not going to be in Toronto anymore. He could be on a bad team somewhere.
I don't have much of an argument with that. I could see where you're coming from with Frederik Andersen. Binnington, I have a bad taste in my mouth with Binnington, what I saw in the playoffs. And, you know, yeah, again, want to see some – yeah, he was really bad. Want to see some more games from him. I can see where you're coming from with Andersen. It's not a slam dunk, though. I mean, you'll get a zillion different answers on that question. Grooby-dooby-doo, Binnington, or Andersen. I think if you talk to three different people, you might get three different answers.
Yeah.
I've got him ranked Andersen first, Binnington second, Grubauer third. The only reason I know Binnington, he didn't look good in the postseason, but he's proven that he can play a lot of games. And so does Andersen. Anderson's a big time workhorse. So that's where this season can get a little wonky. If you're starting guys on back-to-back nights, if the schedule is condensed into a shorter amount of time, I've got to get a guy that can start back-to-back. Binnington can. Anderson can for sure. And especially with the Toronto Maple Leafs, they really improved their defense. TJ Brody is a wonderful, wonderful defenseman. He's going to help Anderson a lot. I think their defense took a big step forward this year, which is probably going to be the difference between them losing in the first round and winning in the first round, in my opinion, at least. And then secondly, for Binnington, it's just that the Blues are so safe. Even without Tarasenko, you see guys like Robert Thomas, who's probably going to have a breakout season. You see guys like Kyrou, who can put the puck in the back of the net. They got like third or fourth liners that could get 20 goals there. And their defense with Torrey Krug now on the back end, I think he's going to be a great fit for that team. Pareko's going to have a good season this year. So I think they have enough safety nets around them where Binnington should be fine, even if his individual performance is a little bit less stellar than what we saw his rookie season. And then Grubauer, I like the player. I love the team, but he gets banged up every year, got banged up in the postseason. And you just can't risk that when you've got a condensed schedule. If a guy can't start back-to-back in any situation, you're not going to get full value in fantasy for that.
Well, the goalie master has weighed in. He gave me a call. He's listening live, apparently. He's tapped into our live stream. So I asked him, Frederik Andersen, Grooby-dooby-doo, or Binnington? You know what his answer was? Mackenzie Blackwood. Are you kidding me? That's all you need to know with Davey Satriano. It always goes right back to the Devils, and he'll take Mackenzie Blackwood over those three. No, in all seriousness, though, I did text him, and he agrees with Petey. He likes Frederik Andersen in that spot.
I think Robbie said the same thing, too. So we're all big on Freddie to redeem himself. And one thing for Freddie, so now Barry's gone, so Morgan Riley's number one defenseman. And when healthy, Jake Muzzin is a really strong piece. You could say maybe he's the backbone to that defense when he's out with an injury, which he is every so often, unfortunately, at this stage of his career. But he is a championship caliber player from his days with the Kings. And when he's healthy, I feel like the Leafs could go very far in the playoffs and could certainly surprise people in fantasy. But don't be surprised if Frederik Andersen is top five in the league and wins, because he's been there before. And one other note on Binnington, who you mentioned, Robbie, third in the NHL in wins last season, very quietly after that amazing rookie season, couldn't have gone any better. And then third in the NHL in wins behind Vasilevsky and Hellebuck. So yeah, I was a little sour on the Blues after the playoffs. I was a little worried because I think Krug is a little bit of a downgrade in terms of overall well-rounded defenseman compared to Pietrangelo. But I think you convinced me the other day, Robbie, that, you know, we got to get Binnington up back closer to the top 10 and forget about some of those things.
They're just so deep, and they've been one of the best run teams in the past 5-7 years in terms of drafting, free agent signings, development. Like they are just a model organization in the league. So that's where I give Binnington credit. I do have to bring up this fan question here. I now have personal stock in this question, which I will I'll tell you guys about on the show. It's Markstrom versus Holtby versus Demko. So I was the first person to maybe, you know, critique the Flames a little bit for throwing all that money at Markstrom, but I'm the same guy that traded a first round pick in a keeper league to get Markstrom on my team. The reason I traded a first round pick is it was really, I think, pick 140 overall. So it wasn't like your typical first round pick in a keeper league. Okay. But Markstrom, 7 points for a goalie win in that league. And I just feel like Calgary quietly is doing the right things behind the scenes. They're not making big splashes. I mean, you could argue that Markstrom is a big splash, But I think I'm going Markstrom here. I don't know. I'm changing the tune now that I've got stock in Markstrom. I'm rooting for the company to succeed.
I love it. Look at what Calgary did last year. Remember the final four games of that series against Dallas, with the, they still almost won that series. You could even say maybe they should have won game four, which would have put them up 3-1. But they played the last four games of that series without Matthew Tkachuk, who was the best player on that team. It's not Johnny Gaudreau anymore. I think it's Matthew Tkachuk. He's only like 23 years old, I think. And he's just like sky is the limit type thing. So put all that together, solidified top two lines, Markstrom improvement in goal over Riddick / Talbot, and then adding Chris Tanev. I mean, the list goes on. They got a lot better. They have some prospects to integrate. They got that kid Valimaki, who's coming over from the Finnish league after missing all of last season because of injury. So all of that, and also the familiarity with Tanev. That's such a great storyline for Markstrom to carry over his success. So as much as I like Vancouver, I think that like the chance for him to be a full-time starter again, prove that he's worth the money. He's one of those guys that you still don't quite look at as a bona fide number one elite goalie, but he was last year. He was darn good the year before that, really good in the playoffs before he got injured, and now has a chance to translate it to Calgary, I think.
And Tana was a firsthand witness, accomplice to having Markstrom have to stand on his head so many games from the Canucks last season. So nobody knows it better than Tanev on the blue line. I do think that the Canucks are a more intriguing team for me in fantasy in terms of value. But when you're looking at the goalie position, I was looking at Braden Holtby's numbers with doing an analytics piece on them. Holy moly. They went off a cliff the past three seasons, trending down, down, and down. So I would first say that Braden Holtby is a great player, world-class goalie, but I think he's due for a little bit of a bounce back. I think a change of scenery is good for him. But if it were down to me and I was choosing between Markstrom, Holtby, or Demko, I would certainly go Markstrom just because I think the Calgary is a safe team. They're not as high-end as Vancouver. But when I'm looking at a goalie, I need there to at least be some semblance of safety, Pete, at that position for my team.
And one last thing on the Vancouver guys. I mean, that could be one of the true 50-50 timeshare goalie situations, I think. The more that I think about it, we loved that they got Holtby to replace Markstrom. It was maybe even an upgrade. But the way that Demko played in the playoffs, and he's in the final year of his entry-level contract, they're going to play Demko a lot, maybe just as much as they play Braden Holtby, because they are a team that is destined to maybe once again win multiple rounds in the playoffs. And I think they're going to want to figure out this regular season, which guy is maybe makes them more equipped to do so. So, and both of them are great options. What Demko did in the playoffs facing elimination as a rookie eligible player was unforeseen and spectacular, really, to be honest. So yeah, I think that Holtby is not home free with the starting job in Vancouver. They're both going to be really viable guys. I would try to get both of them. If you have an opportunity to, I mean, you could get both of those guys. You could get Holtby outside, maybe around the top 75, and then Demko a round or two later and lock it up. And Vancouver's trending, I think, in the right direction over the long term.
Yeah, I would think that would be the perfect handcuff if you're talking goalies, right? The perfect tandem. You know, Vegas probably up there also. But yeah, I like what you're saying there, Petey, with the Vancouver goalie situation. What else? We've gone a little bit overtime here, folks. Robbie's got something last thing. Go ahead, Robbie.
Last thing I'm throwing out there, and we're going to end on this, the bounce back. Who's more likely to bounce back? I'll ask you guys both this season. We've got Cam Atkinson or Alex Debrinket. The reason I'm ending on this is Cam Atkinson is active on Twitter. He's liking our fantasy stuff. He believes in himself to have a bounce back season. I like the Blue Jackets this year. I just feel safer about that team. So I'm going to side with a fan of the show, Cam Atkinson here. Who do you guys got?
It's crazy because both of those guys scored 40-plus goals the previous year. DeBrincat, if he plays with Patrick Kane, has a chance to get back to 30-35, but that Blackhawks team on the back end is really worrisome. So I would go with the safer bet, Cam Atkinson. Like we've said in previous shows, whether he plays with Dubois, whether he plays with Max Domi, it's a great spot for him to get back into that upper echelon of goal scoring around the league. So I'll go with our buddy Cam as well.
Consensus, Cam Atkinson, plays with an edge, a chip on his shoulder, has something to prove. He's excited to come back and have a better year. Columbus has a good team, a real good team. Give me Cam Atkinson. And not only because he likes our tweets or gives us a thumbs up here and there, it's because truly I think Cam Atkinson is more bound to have a bounce back season than a lot of these other guys we're throwing out there. So Cam, let's go.
And Columbus, you can win your fantasy league if you're drafting these guys in the 130, 140, 150 range, whether it's Merzlikins, Atkinson, Pierre-Luc Dubois, very sneaky team. We'll end on that. All of our episodes to date in the offseason are fresh. They're current. You can go back, click on any one of those, get more insight from us. If we don't answer your question directly, hit us up on Twitter at NHL Reese for myself, at NHL Jensen for Petey, at Aircheck for Bobby.
Season preview content galore, and we're hoping to get an announcement soon here, right around the pipe. Hopefully we know when this season starts. And like I continue to say, and we'll say again, we are looking forward to the full over under futures, who we taking here, who we taking there. So stand by for that episode with our pal Michael Leboff from the Action Network. He's going to join us. Wrap it up,
Pete. For sure. That's one of the best episodes of the year, for sure. Some of the other episodes we got, back in the hopper, we have, of course, the goalie tandem rankings. We got the mock draft 1.0, the sleepers, the breakouts, the bounce backs, the free agency recap. If we didn't tell the whole story here today, we probably did in one of those previous episodes. So again, for Bob Bender, Rob Reese, Pete Jensen, thanks for listening. NHL Fantasy on Ice. Leave us a review. Thanks for tuning in. We'll talk to you next time.